Hello students, welcome to UGC EPG Partial on Criminology. I am Neeraj Tiwari, faculty at National Law University, Delhi. And I am here to present the module on International Criminal Court and Victims. This module is part of the paper on Victimology and Victim Justice. Let us begin with the introduction of this module first. At the international level, the initial efforts to document rights of victims can be seen in the resolution of the United Nations. It will be right to say that the major breakthrough to address victims' concern has begun with the adoption of resolution on the Declaration of Basic Principles of Justice for Victims of Crime and Abuse of Power, 1985, to be referred as Basic Principles in this module. Nearly after two decades, UN has adopted another resolution, namely Guidelines on the Right to a Remedy and Reparation for Victims of Gross Violations of International Human Rights Law and Serious Violations of International Humanitarian Law, 2006, to be referred as Guidelines in this module. These resolutions have been source of encouragement for various jurisdictions dealing with victim-related issues in their respective jurisdictions. While the basic principles focus on victims of domestic crimes, the guidelines deal with the victims of international crimes. At regional level, parallel developments have also been noticed in the decisions of European Court of Human Rights and the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. Amidst these developments, one of the most important recognitions of the victims as a subject of international criminal law is contained in the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court. The statute scheme reflects the most advanced position that exists in established international criminal justice. Undoubtedly, the inclusion of victim-centric approach in ICC proceedings were largely driven by the developments of victims' rights in international law. The ethos behind the basic principles has been substantially incorporated into the Rome Statute. Learning outcomes. Let us see what all a reader can learn out of this module. And the object of this module is to present a comprehensive framework of provisions of the Rome Statute and rules for procedure and evidence dealing with issues relating to victims. Second, to make the learners aware of the participatory regime established under the Rome Statute and rule for procedure and evidence for victims. Thirdly, to make the learners understand the reparations proceeding before the ICC. Fourthly, to acquaint the learners with the victim assistance procedure of the ICC. So let us see the interrelation between ICC and victims. So victims' participation is one of the novelties of the Rome Statute of the ICC, with the aim of integrating a restorative element into the proceedings. The victims are given both the opportunity to be heard and to claim reparations. ICC statute has set an unprecedented standard in international criminal law by ensuring effective victim participation. ICC statute has left behind its predecessors, that is ICTR and ICTY, and incorporated an effective victim-centric framework. The statute recognizes several significant principles concerning victims, like victim participation in the proceedings, second, protection of victims and witnesses during court proceedings, and thirdly, the right to reparations. It was believed that ICC's incorporation of participatory rights will help restore victims' sense of dignity, contribute to their healing and rehabilitation, and bring to light facts and evidence that may not otherwise emerge. The experience of victim participation have shown that victims are not there to compete with other stakeholders, but to help in delivery of complete justice. Now let us see definition of victim under the Rome Statute. The Rome Statute does not define victims. The definition of victims is contained in Rule 85 of the Rule of Procedure and Evidence, which is largely based on those contained in the UN Basic Principles and UN Guidelines. These are considered as core documents on victim issues at international level, as they take into account the existing international norms with regard to victims' rights. Rule 85 of ICCRP defines victims as natural persons who have suffered harm as a result of the commission of any crime within the jurisdiction of the court, and organizations or institutions that have sustained direct harm to any of their property. To qualify as a victim, the applicant must therefore be a natural or a legal person and prove that he or she or it suffered harm resulting from a crime that falls within the ICC jurisdiction, and that a causal link between the crime and the harm suffered exists. The definition of victims set out in Rule 85 RPE is broader than those set out in its predecessors like ICTY and ICTR. Rule 85 covers all persons who have directly or indirectly suffered any harm as a result of a commission of any crime within the jurisdiction of the court. The ICC definition of victim is extended to cover even organizations, which in a way broader than the definition of victim contained in the UN Basic Principles, which is limited to natural persons and does not include legal persons. Now, let us see the participatory regime within the ICC, and we'll discuss in this sub-theme the framework for victims' participation in ICC. The ICC model of victim participation is seen as an important innovation in international criminal justice. Some commentators describe it as emergence of new era in victim participation in international criminal law. The Rome Statute allows victims to participate in pretrial, trial, and reparation proceedings. It must be ensured that such participation is exercised in a manner which is not prejudicial to or inconsistent with the rights of the accused and a fair and impartial trial. Article 68(3) is the key provision of the ICC Rome Statute in respect to victims' participatory rights, which deals with protection of victims and witnesses and ensures their participation in the proceedings. It states, where the personal interests of the victims are affected, the court shall permit their views and concerns to be presented and considered at stages of the proceedings determined to be appropriate by the court and in a manner which is not prejudicial to or inconsistent with the rights of the accused and a fair and impartial trial. Such views and concerns may be presented by the legal representatives of the victims where the court considers it appropriate, in accordance with the rules of procedure and evidence. So only a person who qualifies as a victim under Rule 85 can seek participation as per Article 68(3). The prerequisites to participation is the affectation of personal interest of the victim by the proceeding in which participation is sought. The ICC Appeals Chamber, in the case of Prosecutor versus Thomas Lubanga Dialo, in situation in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, July 11, 2008 decision, clarified that the effect of Article 68(3) of the statute is that the participation of victims in the trial proceedings pursuant to the procedure set out in Rule 89 subclause 1 of the rules is limited to those victims who are linked to the charges. Victims will first have to demonstrate that their personal interests are affected by the trial in order to be permitted to present their views and concerns at stages of the proceedings determined to be appropriate by the court and in a manner which is not prejudicial or inconsistent with the rights of the accused and a fair and impartial trial. For the purpose of participation in the trial proceedings, the harm alleged by the victim and the concept of personal interest under Article 68 subclause 3 of the statute must be linked with the particular crime charged. If the applicant fails to demonstrate a link between the harm suffered and the particular crimes charged, then even if his or her personal interests are affected by an issue in the trial, it would not be appropriate under Article 68(3), read with Rule 85 and 89(1) of the rules, for his or her views and concerns to be presented. Thus, the Appeals Chamber concluded that only victims who are victims of the crimes charged and who may demonstrate the link between the harm and the crime charged may participate in the trial proceedings pursuant to Article 68 subclause 3 of the statute, read with Rule 85 and 89(1) of the rules. In Prosecutor versus Thomas Lubanga Diallo case, the appeals chamber encountered with another issue concerning competency of victims to lead evidence pertaining to the guilt or innocence of the accused and challenging the admissibility or relevance of the evidence. The appeals chamber admitted that, quote unquote, the right to lead evidence pertaining to the guilt or innocence of the accused and the right to challenge the admissibility or relevance of evidence in trial proceedings lies primarily with the parties, namely the prosecutor and the defense. The onus to prove guilt of the accused lies on the prosecutor. Presumptively, it is the prosecutor's function to lead evidence of the guilt of the accused. But this does not preclude the possibility for victims to lead evidence pertaining to the guilt or innocence of the accused and to challenge the admissibility or relevance of evidence during the trial proceeding. The appeals chamber noted that, quote unquote, to give effect to the spirit and intention of Article 68 sub clause 3 of the statute, in the context of the trial proceedings, it must be interpreted so as to make participation by victims meaningful. If victims were generally and under all circumstances precluded from tendering evidence relating to the guilt or innocence of the accused and from challenging the admissibility or relevance of the evidence, their right to participate in the trial would potentially become ineffectual. A conjoint interpretation of Article 69(3), second sentence, read with Article 68(3) and Rule 91(3) of the RPE, opens the possibility for victims to move the chamber to request the submission of all evidence that it considers necessary for the determination of the truth. The trial chamber did not create an unfettered right for victims to lead or challenge evidence. Instead, victims are required to demonstrate why their interests are affected by the evidence or issues upon which the chamber will decide on a case-to-case basis whether or not to allow such participation. This way, the appeals chamber confirmed the victim's participatory rights, including submission of evidence and challenges to the admissibility and relevance of evidence, with the safeguards mentioned in para 99 of the decision, keeping in view the prosecutor's burden to prove the accused's guilt and accused's right to fair trial. Now let us see the modalities of victim participation in the ICC proceedings. So Rule 85 subclause A of the Rule of Procedure and Evidence provides that the participatory rights will be granted only to those victims who have suffered harm from a crime within the court's jurisdiction. If any victim qualifies this condition, he or she has to prove that his or her suffering is related to the issues on appeal. Under the ICC regime, victims are allowed to submit observations concerning matters of jurisdiction and admissibility, to make representations to the pretrial chambers concerning proprio motu applications, to express their views and concerns on any matter affecting their personal interest throughout all stages of the proceedings, and to appeal reparation orders. Now let us discuss the victim's participation at pretrial proceeding before the ICC. As stated before, victim participation is one of the novelties of the ICC. Probably for the first time, victim's role is recognized beyond that of a witness and he/she can actively participate in the ICC proceedings. Broadly, the provisions of Rome Statute and the Rule of Procedure and Evidence relevant to victim's participation at the pretrial stages can be summarized as follows. Article 15 subclause 3 of Part 2 of the statute and Rule 50 RPE provides submission of representations to PTC concerning the prosecutor's decision to proceed with an investigation. Similarly, Article 19(3) of Part 2 of the statute and Rule 59 RPE provides for submission of observations concerning jurisdiction and admissibility of cases. Again, Article 53 subclause 3, 61 and 68 subclause 3 and Rules 89 to 92 RPE deals with victims' participation and representation. Rule 93 RPE provides for seeking the views of victims on any issue by a chamber. It includes both victims who are participating in the proceeding and other victims as well. Further, these regimes allow victims' involvement at an early stage as well, which are cited hereinafter. Article 15, subclause 3, and rules 51 and 3, 92, subclause 2, and 107, subclause 5, allow for the involvement of victims before the initiation of an investigation. Article 19 allows for the involvement of victims at the stage where a case has been brought before the court. Similarly, Article 61 provides for the participation of victims at the stage of the confirmation of the charges. And lastly, Article 68, subclause 3, does not prescribe a time frame within which victims are able to be involved in the proceedings. Now, let us discuss the rights of victims or the protection of victims' interest at pre-trial stage. By virtue of Article 42, subclause 1 of the statute, the authority to conduct investigation is vested in the prosecutor. Protection and promotion of victims' interest is a recurring theme of the statute. Article 68, subclause 1 bounds the prosecutor to take measures protective of the safety and well-being of victims. Under Article 53, subclause 1, subclause C, victims' interest is one of the factors to which prosecutors should give due importance while deciding whether to start an investigation in any crime. Likewise, Articles 54, subclause 1, subclause B cast a duty on the prosecutor to respect the interest and personal circumstances of victims and witnesses in carrying out the investigation. Rule 92, subclause 2 of RPE requires the prosecutor to notify victims of his decision not to start investigation. In such scenario, victims may submit representations to the PTC, which may order the prosecutor to initiate the investigation. The prosecutor should take in account victims' interest while deciding to mount prosecution. Through these provisions, the statute has ensured that victims' interest should be protected during investigation stage as well. Now let us go through the decisions of the ICC on participation of victims at pretrial stage. Once the PTC has authorized an investigation, persons seeking to participate must submit an application to the chambers as per Rule 89, subclause 1. To be eligible, the applicant must show that he is a victim and fulfills the criteria mentioned in Rule 85, that is, he is a natural person, suffered harm caused by the crime, and within the jurisdiction of the court. The term harm is not defined in the rule, but the chambers have interpreted it to mean physical, mental, emotional, or economic loss. In one of its decisions, in situation in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, pretrial chamber 1, dated January 17, 2006, the PTC1 had acknowledged procedural status to victims and accorded victims a participatory role in the investigation of a situation. The PTC1 had acknowledged that procedural status emerges from Article 68(3) of the statute. The PTC1 observed that the right to present their views and concerns and to file material pertaining to the ongoing investigation stems from the fact that the victim's personal interests are affected because it is at this stage that the persons allegedly responsible for the crimes from which they suffered must be identified as a first step towards their indictment. The decision of PTC1 was challenged before the appeals chamber in situation in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, a judgment on victims' participation in the investigation stage of the proceedings dated 19 December 2008, which overturned the findings of the PTC1. It was observed by the appeals chamber that participation within the meaning of Article 68, subclause 3 means participation in a proceeding, which in turn denotes to a judicial cause pending before a chamber. In contrast, an investigation is not a judicial proceeding, but an inquiry conducted by the prosecutor into the commission of a crime. It is interesting to note that The prosecutor had taken this line of argument before the PTC 1, which the chamber had rejected then. Thus, the appeals chamber concluded that the PTC 1 has treated Article 68 subclause 3 as a hybrid provision and extended it beyond its self-evident confines. This approach can't find any justification under the statute or the rules for procedure and evidence. Victims cannot be granted procedural status conferring a general right to participate in the investigation. Though victims are not precluded from seeking participation in any judicial proceedings, including proceedings affecting investigations, provided their personal interests are affected by the issues arising for resolution. It is to be noted that the pretrial chamber, in its decision, did not invoke the explicit regime meant for victim participation at pretrial stage. Rather, it invoked Article 68 subclause 3 for according procedural status to victims, which the appeals chamber found to be incorrect. Let us discuss the third limb of victim participation, that is in reparations proceeding. ICC is the first international criminal tribunal that allows for victims to claim for reparations for the harm suffered as a result of the crimes. Alongside the participatory rights, the second unique feature to the Rome Statute is the conferment of rights upon victims to receive reparations. Under the Rome Statute, reparations include restitution, compensation, and rehabilitation, which may be awarded to direct or indirect victims, including legal entities. The ICC chamber may award both individual and collective reparations. Individual reparations can be made directly against the convicted person. Generally, these reparations are awarded directly by the chamber, except in situations where it is impossible or impracticable to make individual awards directly to each victim. In such scenario, the chamber can order reparations to be awarded through the Victim Trust Fund, known as VTF. The chamber may also order the trust fund to award collective reparations. These reparations are intended to address injuries at a societal level and thus may benefit victims of perpetrators not convicted by the ICC. Collective awards are funded primarily through voluntary contributions to the trust fund as provided in Rule 98 of RPE. On March 3, 2015, the appeals chamber at the ICC issued its first ever judgment on reparations. The appeals chamber in situation in the Democratic Republic of the Congo in the case of the prosecutor versus Thomas Lubanga Diallo, judgment on the appeals against the decision establishing the principles and procedures to be applied to reparations of August 7, 2012, stated that an order for reparations under Article 75 of the statute must contain at a minimum five essential elements. These are: it must be directed against the convicted person, it must establish and inform the convicted person of his or her liability with respect to the reparations awarded in the order, it must specify and provide reasons for the type of reparations order, either collective, individual or both, pursuant to Rules 97 subclause 1 and 98 of the RPE. It must define the harm caused to direct and indirect victims as a result of the crimes for which the person was convicted, as well as identify the modalities of reparations that the trial chamber considers appropriate based on the circumstances of the specific case before it. And lastly, it must identify the victims eligible to benefit from the awards for reparations or set out the criteria of eligibility based on the link between the harm suffered by the victims and the crimes for which the person was convicted. Now let us go through the legal provisions which are relevant as far as the reparation proceeding is concerned. Article 75, along with relevant rules of rule of procedure and evidence and regulation of the trust fund, known as regulation, provide a detailed structure to deal with the reparations in ICC proceedings. As per Rule 94 of RPE, a victim seeking reparations must submit a formal reparation request to the registrar with the following information. First, identity and address of the claimant. Second, description of the injury. Third, location and date of the incident. Fourth, identity of the perpetrator to the extent possible. And fifth, any relevant supporting documents including names and addresses of witnesses. And lastly, a claim for compensation, rehabilitation or restitution of assets. Article 75 explicitly allows victims to participate in the reparation proceedings. It states, the court shall establish principles relating to reparations to or in respect of victims, including restitution, compensation and rehabilitation. On this basis, in its decision, the court may, either upon request or on its own motion, in exceptional circumstances, determine the scope and extent of any damage, loss or injury to or in respect of victims and will state the principles on which it is acting. The court may make an order directly against a convicted person, specifying appropriate reparations to or in respect of victims, including restitution, compensation and rehabilitation. Therefore, the requirement to establish principles relating to reparations is mandatory under Article 75 of the statute. On the basis of these principles, victims may request and the chambers may award the reparations. In the absence of any general court-wide principles relating to reparations, it becomes crucial for trial chambers to determine the basis known as principles which may be applied to award reparations in a given case. Further, Rule 98 of the RPE provides in relevant part that individual awards for reparations shall be made directly against a convicted person. The court may order that an award for reparations against a convicted person be deposited with the trust fund where at the time of making the order, it is impossible or impracticable to make individual awards directly to each victim. The award for reparations thus deposited in the trust fund shall be separated from other resources of the trust fund and shall be forwarded to each victim as soon as possible. The court may order that an award for reparations against a convicted person be made through the trust fund where the number of victims and the scope, forms and modalities of reparations makes a collective award more appropriate. Now let us discuss the eligibility for victims to avail the reparations before the ICC. Though the ICC statute does not explicitly state any precise eligibility condition or criteria to claim reparations, yet the statute and RPE indicate that certain requirements have to be met. Like, reparations may be made directly by the person convicted by the court. Reparations may be indirectly awarded through the trust fund. Since reparations can be awarded to victims only, it is pertinent to explore the definition of victims from the point of view of the reparations. Now, let us discuss the trust fund for victims as far as the reparation is concerned. A reparatory mechanism has been established known as the trust fund for victims under the Rome Statute. Article 79(1) states that a trust fund shall be established by decision of the Assembly of the States parties for the benefit of victims of crime within the jurisdiction of the court and of the families of such victims. The trust fund is used to meet the reparations to victims after a conviction is secured. The resources of trust fund can be used for reparations of those victims of crime who have not participated in the proceeding. The trust fund operates in accordance with its regulations. The trust fund depends upon voluntary contributions and assets collected through fine and forfeitures. Article 75 confers power on ICC courts to order an award for reparations through the trust fund. Rule 98 subclause 5 of the RPE provides that other resources of the trust fund may be used for the benefit of victims subject to the provisions of Article 79. The trust fund's responsibilities include, first, implementation of court-ordered reparations and provision of physical, psychological assistance and material support to the victims and their families. The trust fund may act without a court order for the benefit of victims of crimes within the jurisdiction of the court. This general assistance mandate is triggered when the fund's board of directors considers it necessary to provide physical or psychological rehabilitation or material support for such victims and their families. Another important setup established under the regime of ICC statute is Victims and Witnesses Unit. The aim of the statute is to protect and support the two classes of persons regarded as vulnerable, that is victims and witnesses. For their support and protection, the state provides for establishment of a victim witness unit. Article 43 subclause 6 mandates that the registrar shall set up a victims and witnesses unit within the registry, which shall provide protective measures and security arrangements, counseling and other appropriate assistance to victims and witnesses who appear before the court. These services must be provided in consultation with the office of the prosecutor, which can sense danger to victims and witnesses. Rule 16 of the RPE states that responsibilities of the registrar in respect to management of the unit. The responsibilities include, first, notifying victims, witnesses, their legal representatives of proceedings, assisting victims, witnesses in obtaining legal advice and organizing their legal representation, and provide them with facilities to protect their interest at every stage of the proceedings. Similarly, Rule 17 enumerates measures for support, comfort, and protection of victims, their security and rights. The protective measures may be taken in consultation with the chamber, the prosecutor, and the defense. Article 68 subclause 4 of the statute confers an advisory role on the victim witness unit regarding the protection of the victims and witnesses. It requires that the victims and witnesses unit may advise the prosecutor and the court on appropriate protective measures, security arrangements, counseling, and assistance as given in Articles 43 subclause 6. It may be noted that the advisory role of victim witness unit is discretionary in nature. So let us go through and just recall what we have discussed in this module, in this part known as summary. So the Rome Statute has contributed significantly in addressing victims' concerns. The very definition of victims in the RPE reflects the most advanced approach in recent past. The drafters of Rome Statute had learned from the mistakes of earlier tribunals like ICTR and ICTY and stressed on a victim-centric approach amidst the criticism from some jurisdictions. The three-way scheme to address victims' rights, known as participatory, assistance and protection, and reparations, is a unique feature of the Rome Statute. The establishment of victim witness unit and trust fund for victims are also novel initiatives to provide assistance and support to victims. As mentioned above, some provisions are left for courts to interpret, keeping best interest of victims in mind. Lubanga case is one such example where court has given extensive meaning to the victim's participatory rights. Thank you.